Good morning, students. Welcome to our online sessions. So, dear students, we were doing a lesson that is nutrition in the plants. So, today we shall do the part 3, that is the continuation of the nutrition in the plants. So, in the last session, we were dealing about the other modes of nutrition in the plants. That is how the plants, that is apart from autotrophic, that can prepare their own food by photosynthesis. So, other plants, that is heterotrophs, how they will obtain their nutrients. So that we were dealing among that, one is the parasitic mode of nutrition, insectivorous mode of nutrition. Now we shall deal with the saprophytic type of nutrition. You would have seen the packets of that the molds, that is the fungus, so that is the mushroom. So these mushrooms, they are edible. So this mushroom, and also if we keep a loaf of bread in the open damp places for minimum 2 to 3 days, we can see there will be growth of a cottony growth like structure. So it will be very much a cottony, and then the color also sometimes in the coconut also, fresh coconut if we cut open and if we keep in the damp place, we can see pinkish growth color. And also in the bread also, on that loaf of bread also, we can see the blackish or greenish cottony growth. So this cottony growth is nothing but the fungus. Now let us study in this session how this fungus, it will derive its nutrition. So this fungus, even though they come under the kingdom plantae, they are deficient of the very important pigment that is responsible for the photosynthesis, that is the chlorophyll. So this fungus, they don't have chlorophyll at all. Then if there is no chlorophyll, obviously the plants cannot carry out the process, that is the photosynthesis. If there is no photosynthesis, then definitely they cannot prepare their own food. Then let us study how this saprophytic type of plants, it can derive its nutrition. So these plants, that is the mushrooms or the molds, yeast, fungi, they depend on the dead and decaying organic matter. So once again I repeat, the fungus like the molds or the yeast and the mushroom, they belong to the saprophytic, and these plants, they derive their food from the, or they derive the nutrients from the dead and decaying organic matter. So this loaf of bread, it is organic in nature because it is prepared from the plant origin, that is the wheat. And this mushroom, usually what has seen after the rainy season, around the basal part of the tree trunk, you can see that the growth of the mushroom, because then all the remnants of that plant, it will drop off, it will undergo decay, and the decaying process will enhance the humus, and utilizing that fertility or the organic, dead and decaying organic matter, these molds or the fungus, it will grow. So this is how the molds or the fungus and the mushroom or the yeast cell, it will derive its nutrition. And these molds or this type of nutrition, it is called as the saprophytic nutrition, and the plants are called as the saprotrophs. So plants are referred to as saprotrophs, and the mode of nutrition, it is known as saprophytic. That means the plants that derive their nutrition from the dead and decaying organic matter. So they can utilize the nutritional requirement by decayed organic matter. That is known as the saprophytic type of nutrition. And the plants are referred to as saprotrophs. And these molds or the fungus, the economical importance, if you come to the to know about the economical importance, some of the fungus, they are usually useful for us, and many of the fungus, they are harmful. Mainly because these fungus, it will hamper or they will damage the crop plants. And also some of the very good usage of these fungus is yeast cell, that will help in the curdling of the meat. And these yeast actually is very good for our intestine. And also these molds, that is the yeast, it is used in the leavening of the dough, especially in the bakeries. And also mushroom, but not all mushrooms are edible. Only few of the selected species are edible, but many of the mushrooms are poisonous also. By seeing that one, we have to consume only the edible form of the mushrooms. So if you see these molds under the microscope, we can see the body of the fungus. So here you can see the long thread-like structures entangled with each other, and the fruiting body at the edge of this hypha, we can see the fruiting body called as the sporangium. And this sporangium, wearing any leather shoes and all. So if we are using and if we are keeping it for long duration, after certain duration, if we open and see, we can see the growth of that cotton ingrown, that is the fungus. So you may wonder from where actually this fungus has come, because these sporangia, when they burst open, these spores will be spread in the atmosphere, and these spores, when they lodge upon like these organic matter, and they will grow, because that leather outside is organic, it is coming from the animal origin. And coconut also, if we break open the coconut, fresh coconut, and if we keep for 2 to 3 days, it will result in the growth of the fungus. So in order to do this activity, a simple activity, you can also do it in your home. So take 1 slice of bread, sprinkle some water, only moist it should become, not wet, only moist we should make it, and keep it near the damp place for 2 to 3 days. Because for the growth of the fungus, minimum it requires 2 to 3 days. So after 2 to 3 days, if you see, we can see the cotton growth. So you have not put any spores or fungus on that one. Only the thing is, we have taken the loaf of bread and then sprinkled the water to make it damp and kept it for 2 to 3 days. So the spores that are present, suspended in the atmosphere, it will lodge upon and utilize this organic matter and develop into the many of the hundreds and thousands of cells, making appearance of that cottony growth. So this is how the saprophytic nutrition we can see in the environment. Next is the symbiotic mode of nutrition. So here symbiotic, sim means here mutualism, bio means organism or the life. It is a very good association between two organisms. So here two organisms, it is nothing but algae and fungi. One good example I am giving here, the association between the algae and the fungi. Alga, as you know, it is photosynthetic because it is green in color, chlorophyll it is present, and obviously it can undergo photosynthesis. And the fungi, it is a non-photosynthetic because it doesn't contain chlorophyll, it is deficient of chlorophyll. So a very good association, it occurs between the algae and the fungi, and this association we can call it as the lichens. So these lichens, usually it will grow on the rocky area. So on the rocks, especially these algae, it cannot absorb the water. So that in order to absorb the water and break up on the rocks in order to release the nutrient, that will be brought about by the fungi. So that absorption of water and then breaking the rocky material and to release the nutrients, it is brought about by the fungi, and it supplies the raw material for the algae. So this algae, in return, it utilizes these nutrients and brings about photosynthesis and prepares the food and it supplies for the fungi. So here, both the algae and the fungi are mutually they are benefited with each other. Neither the algae is harming the fungi, nor fungi is harming the algae. So that's it. In such a type of association, it is called as the symbiotic association. Another very good example we can say is the lodging of that rhizobium bacterium in the root audience of leguminous plants. So suppose if this is the leguminous plant, so in the root nodules, we can see the, in the roots of that plant, we can see the nodule, and this nodule, if we crush open, we can get the rhizobium bacteria. So this rhizobium, it will reside in the root nodule, it will absorb the nitrogen and it supplies for the plant, and in return, plant is giving the food and shelter for the rhizobium. So this is also one of the classical example for the symbiotic association between the bacteria and the plant. So in symbiotic, neither of the partners are getting harmed. So both are getting equally benefited. So such a type of association, we can call it as the symbiotic association, in which mutually both the organisms are mutually benefited. So this completes the other modes of nutrition under which we have studied 4 types: parasitic, insectivorous, saprophytic, and symbiotic. And in each of these types of mode of nutrition, we have studied differently how the plants adapt themselves and how they absorb the nutrients, mainly because they lack the chlorophyll, or in insectivorous they like they can't, they will develop only in the fields wherein there will be deficiency of nitrogen. So hope children we have understood this one. Now next is the last part of this topic, that is nutrition impacts. How nutrients are replenished in the soil. You might have seen in the crops, they will be grown season after season, season after season. And no doubt, soil it is a rich treasure of minerals and nutrients. So suppose if the farmer is growing season after season, season after season, because of the extensively absorption of nutrients and the minerals from the soil, definitely there will be depletion of nutrients in the soil. If there is depletion of nutrients in the soil, definitely it hampers the growth, luxurious growth of the plant. If there is no growth of the plant, definitely it affects the crop production, that is the amount of harvesting also. So in order to boost up extra energy, that is in order to add the extra fertilizer for the nutrients for the soil, in the soil, the farmers, they will sprinkle the fertilizers. So that addition of nutrients, additional nutrients, they are known as the fertilizers and also the menus. So the farmers, they will supply the profits with extra nutrients in the form of fertilizers and the menu. Fertilizers means they are purely made up of chemicals. Menus means then there is the organic decomposition which is brought about. It is also known as composting, vegetable waste, animal dung, and also the fruit peels, vegetable peel. So all these will be allowed for decomposition for nearly 1 or 1.5 months, and the decomposed part is known as the menu. So these fertilizers and menu, they will help to add up the extra nutrients in order to boost up the fertility of the soil, thereby enhancing the luxurious growth of the plant so that we can get a good harvesting. So naturally also, some of the bacteria, just so I told about the rhizobium. So this rhizobium, it resides in the root modules of the leguminous plant. So this rhizobium, it cannot prepare its own food. That's why it resides in the root nodule. So suppose this is the plant. So in the roots of the leguminous plant, we can see the nodule. Even the methi leaves, what we will use in our kitchen, in that roots also if you observe, you can see the root nodule. So this rhizobium actually it is a bacteria, and this bacteria, it cannot prepare its own food. That's why it resides in the root nodule, and the plant it is preparing the food and it is supplying the food or the nutrients for the bacteria. So this bacteria, it has got a very good ability to convert the free atmospheric nitrogen, and it helps in the fixation of nitrogen into the soil. That is, as you know, major part of the atmospheric gases, it is made up of nitrogen, and this nitrogen, it seems even though it is present freely in the atmosphere, it cannot be utilized by the plant. It has to get converted into the usable form. So this conversion, it is brought about by the rhizobium. It converts into the usable form, and these usable forms, it will get dissolved in the soil, and from the soil, the plants will absorb. So rhizobium, it is helping to supply the nitrogen, and the plant, it will absorb the usable form, prepare its own food through photosynthesis, and the prepared food it supplies for the bacterium. So it is also one of the a very good classical example for symbiotic association. So when the farmers are growing leguminous plant, the farmer no need to add extra fertilizer. So extra fertilizers means it will be the form of NPK, that is nitrogen, phosphorus and potassium. So these are the three major nutrients that has to be supplied in the field in order to enhance the fertility of the soil. So if the farmer is growing any leguminous plant, then no need to supply nitrogen based fertilizer, because the bacterium itself is helping in the fixation, and only the thing is he has to supply the fertilizer rich in the phosphorus and potassium. So this is how the replenishment, that is we have to renew the fertility of the soil for the good harvesting. So dear students, so this completes the chapter nutrition in plants. So hope you have all understood. understood. In the next session, we will come up with a new lesson. So, hope you have understood. Thank you.